Okay, so lost half the crowd during the break, I guess. Arrow function killed them off. We will continue soon with the stuffing of JavaScript. I will just have, I got some questions during the break, so I will answer them to you all. The first one was regarding the examination. Well, like that. The deadline is Monday at noon, 12, 00. So please hand it in before that deadline. And you do that by committing this to the GitHub repository. If you haven't gotten the GitHub repository to sync or have problems with that, please try to resolve those tomorrow or Friday. I have been super busy those past weeks, but Tuesday, Friday, Thursday, Friday, this week, I will have more time. I will be available in Slack in a better extent than before. You can handle in the examination whenever you like. So, it should be. What wasn't available?
If you go all the way down.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I've got a lot of. Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You can hand the code in whenever you like. Tomorrow or Friday, this box below, if you are signed in to CoursePress, you will be able to book a time. And this was what I wanted to say is that there will be probably four simultaneous tracks of times, and one of the tracks will be for those who cannot participate on campus. Then we will do it over Slack, over Skype instead. So if you're a student not able to participate next Wednesday on campus, you need to sign up for the distance time. And it's half an hour. And you book it yourself, you can change your time. And we really, really appreciate if you planning of not showing up, please remove yourself from the registered time, because otherwise we will sit and wait for you. So please take care of this booking. No, you cannot do it yet. I will release the times tomorrow or Friday. We tend to do it that way because it's first. Otherwise, all of you would register the first day, and then half of you would commit the or do the assignment, and then we will sit here waiting for people not showing up. So that's why we do it on all courses. Yeah, you're making a release on that commit tree on GitHub, just following the release guide on GitHub. And if you want to make late changes, please just do another release with incremented release numbers. So the next question I got is, okay, some of you, especially you who read this course as a freestanding course, might not have been programming a lot the last years. You who are program students have probably programmed a lot, so you have this fresh in memory. But if you haven't programmed a lot, where should I start? Because it's a lot of stuff going on at the same time. I would recommend starting with the course page, because the literature for this part of the course is online based. And it's this one, Eloquent JavaScript, the second edition. This will introduce JavaScript in quite a good way. We are having this book even for the first graders who have never programmed before, and it works for them. But it's a good middle ground. If you have programmed a lot, I think you will appreciate this book as well, because it's quite on topic all the time. So I would recommend reading this book from top to bottom. We will, in this course, focus on part one and part two. Part one is for today's and tomorrow's lectures. It's the basics of the language. Part three is working with JavaScript in the browser, and that's the next part of the course. So for the first part of the course, it's the part one in the in this book that is good to go through. Furthermore, I will add external resources. There is one right now. I will add a couple more. Among those, I will add to add a link to MPJ's channel, the Spotify developer, which is really, really good. This one, Crockford on JavaScript, is a, in the JavaScript community, it's a legendary series of lectures by Douglas Crockford. They are getting a bit old. It's like 7-8 years old or something like that, those recordings. So he's talking about JavaScript before ES6, before we have let, before we had arrow functions. But he's in the committee making the decisions, so he kind of know what's going to happen with the language, so he gives a really good introduction to the language. This is a long series of like 6 or 7 lectures, or 8 even. But I would, starting right now, recommend the first one. And that's because this first one will actually only be history. He will talk about the computer science history in general and what led up to JavaScript as a language, going through Lisp and Scheme and stuff. So I definitely recommend this one. And if you like this one, please look at the next one and the next one. And those could actually be like a side rail for the course, because we are following somewhat what he's doing in his lectures. So I highly recommend those. And if you are going to dive into the JavaScript community, I think it's a good idea to have seen those at least, because they meant a lot back then, and they still do, even if some of the thoughts may be obsolete because the language has changed. Otherwise, I could, if you just want to learn how to kind of program again, I would definitely recommend Codecademy or Code School and their JavaScript courses. They have JavaScript courses that are, the first parts are free. So you can just start them up in the browser, do the tutorial kind of programming. For most of you, maybe those are a little bit basic. But if you have forgotten about programming, that's a really good start. So Codecademy or Code School and their interactive JavaScript guides, I highly recommend them. And our first graders, they say they have a lot of use for those courses as well. Okay? Let's go. Feels like I forgot something at the last lecture, so I will just show it because we discussed it on the break. Back to this example. We will actually touch it in this lecture because it has to do with arrays, and we haven't talked about arrays yet, so that's why. Now I remember. Okay. Data structures. You have all had Jonas describing data structures, right? And pipes and stacks and whatever data structures. We won't go into detail in the conceptual model. We will talk implementation, and I think Jonas would say that an array is not a data structure, it's an implementation of a stack or something like that, but I will call it a data structure. So as I see it, we have two data structures in JavaScript. We have arrays and we have objects. And those are the two main things to arrange data.
Would you use arrays and the word list as different meaning, or would you use them interchangeably?
Would I use arrays and
lists?
We don't have lists. In JavaScript, we only have arrays. And I will show you how arrays are implemented, and then you can make your own decision of how to use them. you could probably implement a list or a map or whatever kind of data structure you like using JavaScript and writing it, construct it yourself, or maybe use libraries that have implementations of those concepts. What is the second name? When is the second examination released? I got a question that I missed. Really soon, because that's an assignment that is already existing, so we don't need to write it. So yeah, very soon, probably tomorrow or Friday. Okay, arrays. Have a look at that code. So what are we doing? We are creating an array with three strings, and we have a push method on the array that we could push in another value. We also have a pull if we want to remove something from the array. So this is probably quite familiar. There are some stuff going on here. In Java, you would probably have to say that this should be an array of strings, or this should be an array of ints. We don't have the hard types in JavaScript, so we could, if we like, do that. And this is completely valid. We are writing the length property you're familiar with as well. So this is now an array with five objects because we pushed the 0 to 2. And we could, if we like, just print the array, and then we see the result down here, and the 45 is there. So we are mixing numbers and strings, and we could add objects. We could add another array inside this array. Doesn't matter. I would not do that. I would. If you're looking for something where you need to alter, to have both strings and numbers, it's probably not an array you're looking for. You're probably looking for an object instead. So normally arrays, even if they are not explicitly one type, you often use array with only one type at each element in the array. I just printed this, and when I console log the array, the console log method will like show us a pretty representation, a string representation of the array. So that's what's going on. Most likely you would do something like this, right? To print 45. No, 101. To print 1 DV. Oh. What? Yeah, the number, but I added. No, I didn't. I removed it. Oh, sorry. Yeah, I looked at that array. So I thought it would print that one, but of course not. Yeah. So, and it's null terminated as usual. We start, the first index is 0. So nothing strange here. Then it's quite easy. If we on the examination ask you, how do you create a new array? The correct answer is that is a new array, brackets, and then you have an array. And then if you want to, you just add stuff to it. And all of you are sitting wondering, oh, because you are so taught in performance, right? So you are probably wondering, but isn't there a lot of memory allocation going on when we are like dynamically changing the size and stuff on this array? Shouldn't we be able to like say that we need an array of the size 250, and then so we can allocate it all in memory, and we will like earn a millisecond here and a millisecond there, and everybody will be happy? But probably slow. I'm not sure. Often I don't care. I mean, the applications you will write won't be like quantum physics in the browser or whatever. You have probably special languages dealing with that kind of problems. In JavaScript, you will find yourself in moving data a lot. Arrays of data forward and backward, getting data from one API, combining it with data from another, building new arrays, just sending them on and off. And of course, there are probably a lot of optimizations you could do if you really, really need to speed things up because you have, say, 200,000 objects in this array, and it will be slow to iterate over it, and you will need some kind of hash mapping or whatever to be able to search or how you do stuff like that. But we really don't need to focus on that right now, because when it comes to the browser, rendering something on the browser is so much more time consuming than anything you can do with arrays in JavaScript, more or less, because that is what takes time, and the user takes time. So please don't do premature optimization, is what I'm saying. If you find yourself in a situation where something takes like 5 seconds and the user sits waiting, then find out why does this take 5 seconds. Yeah, probably because the network call to another server is slow or something like that. Probably not because you are using a for loop in a using plus plus instead of I plus equals or something like that in the for loop. Yeah. As I said in the last lecture, using const is like telling everybody who reads the code that I don't have an attention of changing this reference ever. I always want this array reference to reference this array and nothing else. So I'm not able to change. I mean, I can push to this one because it's a reference, and I'm only pushing to into the array like that. So that's okay. But I can never reassign this to a new array. So you can use let all the time if you like, but this could be like a message to those who read the code that I have no intention of changing this variable. Okay. You can read up on arrays on this link. It has the properties you're used to, more or less. But we will get into the interesting stuff. And now we have some kind of practical application of the stuff I talked to before the break, about arrow functions and higher order functions. This is where it becomes like a little bit interesting. So, I've given the solution away, but if you weren't fast, if you got this code in Java or another language like that, how would you go about? I would give you the task of writing those all values of the array into the console. How would you do it? A simplest way. For loop. Yeah. I love for loops. Did I say that last time? Yeah. So we would do something like for equals 0. Course code punct length. I plus equals 1. And we will do a console.log course code. Okay. Yeah. Something like that, right? Well, yep. Printing them. Yep. Common knowledge. That's not wrong in any way. It's probably quite fast. But there is a cooler way of doing it. Yeah.
if you wanted to print them on the same line, how do you do it?
Print them on the same line. You will need to store them in a string and then print the string, and that would probably be the best. Best way of doing this. And maybe, yeah, there are some fancy new functions that I haven't learned in the ES6 for doing string concatenations in a more beautiful way than this. This is a little bit, without adding any logic, it will be hard, but something like that. We would need some kind of expression to find out if it's the first or the last one. We added an extra space in the end, but oh, whatever. But yeah. Okay, so there is a more fancy way of doing this, and that is using something called iterator functions. Iterator functions. So, what is an iterator function? On the array type, and I say type, I don't say class, I say type, because arrays are type, or most of the stuff we do in JavaScript we call types. So in the array type, there are iterator functions. So on this array, there is a function called for each, which my editor didn't recognize. So for each is an iterator function. What this is it takes a function as an argument. So for each expects us to send it a function, and it will use this function or call this function for each element in the array. So I will write this using function this syntax first, because it might be easier to grasp. So it will call this function with a couple of arguments. One of the arguments is it's each element in the array. So the first time this function will be called, it will have call it with this first string, and then the next, and then the next, and then the next. And we can take them as a parameter to the function and do something with this. Console log the course. That. And we see that the three courses are logged. If we like, we could get some, I'm not sure, but I think the next one is the iterator number. So we get 0, 1, if we need a number of some reason. Often we don't. So we only need the value, because it's the value that is interesting. Okay. Couldn't we then replace this with an arrow function? Of course. As I said, if it's an arrow function with one parameter, we don't need parentheses. So we could actually just do it like that. So for each course, do that. And now you see the greatness of arrow functions. They were really hard to grasp when I chained them together and had them in a long line. But actually, if you have never programmed in your life, I guess this makes quite more sense than a for loop. Because, okay, we have course codes, should say course codes. For each course code, we get the course and we do something with the course. What do we do with the course? We log it. So it's a really, really neat way of reading this. Let's try it out. Course is the parameter to the function we are.
You can choose whatever you want.
Yeah, I could. It's logical to call it course, but it's not uncommon that you use value.
So, I mean, in other words, I.
Yeah. No, not I, because I kind of implicates that it's an iterator, like 0, 1, 2, 3. This is the actual string. So this is this, or whatever string number or whatever is in the first position in the array, or second or third. Okay? This is not a good idea, right? We shouldn't log stuff because we have a function with side effects. What should we do? we should return, right? So this one should probably return course. And if it's returning course from a function, we could write it like that. Right. Let's see. Yep. And we can store the values. Yeah, we will only return them and then into and store them in a new array. So that was quite stupid in this case. I will present a better case soon. So that was the for each. We have another other functions iterate the for each just loops. It doesn't do anything. It just loops over over the array. And I would say you should really learn for each because it makes everything so much easier. There are other iterator functions. We have filter. And what filter does is it kind of, it returns a value based upon if it fulfills, if something's true or not. So in this case, we have our course codes and we filter course codes, we filter, I called it node in this time. This time, we don't need that one. I'm not sure why I added it. And what we say here is return. So filter says, give us the node. So this one is an iterator, so we get the first, the second, and the third. If the character at 3, 0, 1, 2, 3, is a 5, then So if this expression is true, then the filter method will add this value to a new array. So what this does is it filters the first array and finds all courses that are 500 courses. So after this, we get an array looking like that. So that's what filter does. We have map, reduce, and sort. If you like to sort something, reduce if you just want to, I will show that one, but you can do something with the values. So you can take an array of numbers and you can add them all together to one number. I will show that as well. So I think we have an example. No. Now the Python man should wake up. Because I think this is what you asked before. In ES 2015, we have something called rest parameters and spread operators. This example shows what it is. So we have a function called register function, register student, that takes a name, an age, and a courses. Okay, if you were supposed to design this, you probably say that the courses should be an array of courses if you designed this function. But you have when you were new to programming or at databases or something, you learn that doing stuff like this, that's not a good thing, right? A student probably only needs to register on 3 courses. So we add 3 parameters here, and then we are fine. No, all of you hopefully agrees with that taking the courses as an array is a better solution to this problem. Am I right? Yeah, kind of. So you would probably take something like courses array or something like that. However, you don't need to do it like this in JavaScript if you don't like. You can use the rest parameter notation. So if you add 3 dots like that before an argument, a parameter, this one will catch everything, all arguments sent in after the age. So when we call this one, ln will be matched to name, 30 will be matched to age, and the rest of the arguments will go into the courses as an array. So this one will be an array of everything that was left, everything else. So it will not be tossed away anymore. It will be saved in the courses array. And this is called the rest operator. Is it kind of the same thing as you asked about in Python?
Yeah, almost.
Almost, yeah. I haven't written functions that needs this yet. Maybe I will now when it's there for some reason. But in the language from the beginning, there are a lot of functions working like this. You have, for instance, the math max function. The math.mat max functions works like this. Math.max 1, 4, 3, 2, 5, 2. What do you think is the answer of that one? 4. Yeah, so it basically, you just add arguments to it and it will return the largest one. Yep.
Can you add a new argument of that?
No. How could you? Because you mean like that?
Yeah.
Nope. Is the answer to that one. I have no idea how the interpreters should have. Oh, okay, so it would all so it will work like from the front and the back. And then we should be able to work, actually. But no, it does not. So this one must be the last, apparently.
What about passing that? You can't pass that twice, obviously, but if I want to have two arrays, I have to go all the way the old-fashioned way. I want to pass two arrays to the function.
Yeah, if you want to pass an array to this function, yeah.
Well, like two collections, and I can't use that.
If you have a look at if we pause this one a while, and this one works because we are adding a lot of arguments, so remove that one. In the next lines, I do this. I create an array of courses because it would make more sense to call this function using an array of courses instead of adding them as arguments. Then we could use something called a spread operator. So in this case, it's called the rest operator when it's in the parameter side. When it's in the argument side, it's called spread operator. So what this one does is the opposite. It takes an array and spreads it out as arguments. And now I can answer your question about how to log them on a row, because you would be able to do something like, because the console.log could take everything that should be written as arguments, so we could actually do it like that, and you get that pretty output just like you wanted, because this is the same as just writing them with commas. And if I write hey or something, hop, it will say hey, blank space, hop. But that's just because the console.log console.log function works that way. But you could use the spread operator for that. That answered your question, kind of, right?
Yeah, kind of. Like,
yeah.
So I think it's okay.
Yeah. so, but I mean, I have too little experience with this one to say that, oh, you can use this in those cool ways. I have experience, however, with stuff like this, that there are a couple of functions in JavaScript that takes arguments, and often you want to send in an array. So instead, we could send in an courses, and we will get the answer of which one is the biggest. Or can't we do that? Oh, sorry. Thanks. Yeah, not the number is the, yeah, they couldn't match because they were strings, and math.max obviously works on integers. So, okay, it couldn't do that. But if those were numbers, we could have sent them into the max function. So this can be useful in calling some of the built-in functions. Yeah, you had an example of that below, actually. So functions, arrays, are really important in JavaScript. The next thing that is probably the most important thing is objects. And if we go to the Java, the classical object-oriented world, you have constructions in the language to mimic the nature around you. If you have examples in a Java class, you probably will have something like, we have animals, and the animals are mammals, and the mammals could be ducks, and or it could be dogs, or that was stupid. It could be dogs or sheep or pigs or whatever. So, and you probably have this example of inheritance, right? That the pig will inherit from the mammals that will inherit from animals. And this is the classic object-oriented way, because object-oriented programming is kind of built upon modeling the world around us. And by doing so, you have classes. And a class is like a blueprint or like blueprint for a building or whatever. And you take this blueprint, and out of the blueprint, you construct new buildings. They actually don't have anything. I mean, if you open a window in the building, the window on the blueprint won't start flapping, right? Because the blueprint is just some kind of a blueprint for building this stuff. It's not connected. In JavaScript, it's quite different. We don't have classes. You can create object out of anything, like the Lego of programming. And to create an object is really, really simple. To create an object, as I said with arrays, if we are going to ask you how to create an array, you will say brackets. If we ask you how to create an object, you will say curly brackets. Like that. So that's an object. We have created an object. In Java, you had probably need to create a class, and you need to instantiate from that class using the new keyword, and you get an object. Okay, you could, if you're really, really into stuff like that, you could probably get away with doing something like that. Yeah. So that gets us an object as well using the new keyword. Don't do that. An empty object. It's not an object of something, it's just an object. And this is because you ask that because in Java, if you have an object, it's always an object of something. It's an object of a bird or whatever. In this case, it's just an object. It's just like nothing. We see, it's just an empty object. Nothing there. Just like if you create an array, it's not an array of something, it's just an array which is empty. So this is just an empty object.
So what's the difference between array and object in that?
Not much, actually. In that, an array is an object. It's just a special kind of object. So you could skip arrays and just do objects. But objects are like key value storage. And I will show that if I'm able to do the curly brackets. just to show you that you can do it like that. I removed it. Thanks. So, empty object. Okay? If we want to add something to our object, how do we do it? Oh, we could do it like this. Name. Or I could write it on one line because it's more makes more sense if you have seen arrays. So I said it is a key value storage. So the name colon John. And how do we do it in arrays? Yeah, we have a comma to separate, right? So a comma. An age colon 45. Oh, that was cruel. It's only 40. Sorry. Now we have created an object of what, you ask? I don't know. It's an object with a name and an age. I don't really care what it is. It's just an object. And if we have a look, we can see the output like that. So this is more or less like an array, but instead of just giving it one value, you have a key value like that. Often when you create objects like this, you probably would do something like this for readability. It's easier to read. Don't forget the comma. You will be punished immediately. Okay. So this is only, like now it's just a data structure. We have no functionality in this one. We have no methods. In Java, you would add methods to an object to be able to do something with the state of the object. We can do that as well. Remember that functions can be assigned to variables. So why shouldn't we be able to assign a function to a key value in an object? So let's try that. Like that. Let's do it like this. How do you think you will reference the name? Any guesses? What? Come again? Like that? Let's try. Sorry. We're logging the object. We only need to do object.greet. Need to call the function, of course. John says hi. Fine. Any other ways to do it? This? John says hi. So yeah. Because in this case, this is referring to the object. And so this is just a reference to the object. And this is a reference. Okay, I could have a long discussion about this because this in JavaScript is quite hard to grasp. But for this example, when this function is called, it is called on the keyword on the object obj. So obj is calling the greet function. Then this will point or reference the object that is calling the function. So that's why both this and obj works in this case, because it's the same thing. But of course, when you're writing code, this one might change. This one might end up in an array where you don't have a name to call it. So I would say it would be quite bad practice to call it the identifier of the object. I would use this. Yeah?
You could create a new object with the parameter of name, and you could then the argumented object that it must agree will be the reference to this then. If you print a new,
tell me what to write. Yeah.
If you create a new object with a property of name, yeah, just some name.
Oh. Yeah, I know what you're. Yeah, so you can use something called apply and call. So you can actually use. In this case, the object is the caller. The ob is the caller of the greet function. You could change this so that another object is the caller of the greet function. Can I do that if the function is in another object? Yeah. Let's just see how to do it, since I didn't prepare that.
So you
like this?
Yeah.
Yeah. In this case, nothing will happen, because it will still say John, because we are not doing anything with the object passed. So. Nothing will happen. Will be still say John, because this will always refer to what is calling the function, and you are just passing the object in as a parameter. But you could call the object by using apply, for instance. So you could do it like this. Just a moment. So you can do something like this. Two. I think. This is what you're after.
Yeah.
So what I do now is I tell JavaScript interpreter that I want to call the greet function on the object, but instead of making this point to ob, I'm telling the interpreter to change this into that object. So when this line is executed, it's executed with this pointing to this object too, and because this object too has a parameter or a key called name, this will use this one instead. That was a little bit over course. I didn't plan to talk about this, but this is also a way of, because functions are not bound to an object, you can pass them around and the context can change and the state could change all the time.
A small question about syntax.
Yeah.
Like equivalent to Java, an instance variable, it would work without this keyword. Does it do it here?
Yeah, you mean if you write it like this. The problem is it will not look in the object for this one, because it will be undefined, actually, right? Yeah, name is not defined. If we were to have a name up here, like that, Kalle says hi. And so this is an inner function of this outer scope, so it will not look at the object and finding its properties. It will go out and look at the next scope and try to find name.
And that is closure?
Yeah, it could be a closure, yeah. Because if you return this object to another part of the program and you call the object's greet function, you will have the reference to the name together with when you passed the function. Exactly how the memory is handled, I'm not sure, but it's a closure. Apply and call, you don't need to know them for this course, not right now. I actually think I have an example of using those later on when we come to the browser. So we could let them go right now.
One last question about that.
Yeah. Okay, let's do this. Say hi. We want a method say hi on this object that should say hi. Oh, but we already have something like this on this object, right? We have the greet. Okay. So what we are saying is take the reference to this greet function and assign it to this greet, say hi function. So if I do this, object greet, this is the first object, it will, did I change it to, it's that one, yeah. It will say John says hi. But now I can actually call obj2.sayHi. And it says Johan says hi. So I'm borrowing the function from another object, or composing a new object of existing functions. And this is quite different from Java. You can do composition, I guess, in Java as well. But you are more often likely to do some kind of inheritance that you want to that object 2 inherits object 1, so it gets its functionality. But in JavaScript, you can do composition instead. That is borrowing stuff. So you might have told that, know that, oh, the for each method on arrays. That's really nice. I would like one myself. OK, you could borrow it and use that one instead. If I say greet, yeah, if I say object to greet, if this would have been an inheritance, this would work because it will go up the inheritance chain and look for greet. But in this case, this will not work because there are no greet function on the object 2. You could, of course, call it greet, but we don't.
How do you do inheritance?
Soon. Well, yeah. So this is creating a simple object, like this. Everything is dynamic in JavaScript, so you can change stuff after it has been created. So if I like, I could take this object and add a class. No, that was a bad name. Object.add city. Like that. And if we look at the object, we see, okay, so it added a simple city parameter at the end, property at the end called Kalmar. So you can alter objects all the time. They are not immutable. Even if I say that this is a const, I can change the content. I can't reassign the variable object, but I can change the content. Okay, that's one way of doing it. I said I wanted to add a class, and I kind of remembered that class is a reserved word. You could actually do it like this if you like. So this notation is getting around all, you can name properties any way you like by using this notation that is like array-ish notation. Or what's it called? It's called arrays. What are they called when they have this kind of lookup? I forgot a word. It's a special kind of arrays that has value instead of index, incremental index. Yeah, hash map, bitch, yeah.
Dictionary.
I'm looking for another word, but I can't find it. Tonight I will wake up in my sleep and remembering. This one is quite, I mean, if you would, you could do stuff like, class 34, so we could dynamically create our property names. So you could basically just class 1, 2, 3, 4, but you would not, because you would add an array, but yeah, you could do stuff like that. I don't see that too often. So I would say that you should be familiar with doing stuff like this, because that's quite common, that you need to alter an object. Adding stuff to it.
There is no words like add or something, just dot, and then parameter name, and then values?
Like push to an array or something like that. We have defined property. I will show that in a bit. That's kind of like that you can say, I want to define a property. Then you could make more fine-tuning, because if you're adding a property to this object, it's really just a var you're adding, and you can change that afterwards. By using defined property, you could say that it should be immutable, that it should be frozen, that it should be hidden. You can do a lot of stuff with defined property that you cannot do with this simple notation. I think I have an example of that as well. Oh, this is so much fun. So I forget myself. So we should have a break soon, but not yet. Because this is fun. Fun stuff. This is kind of a real life example, because a lot of stuff in JavaScript is handling data and filtering and sorting and stuff. So I this was late last night, and it's heavily influenced by Stolen, by this example, by MPJ. So please go check out his channel and give him a thumbs up for this example, if you like it. He's using dragons and attacks and stuff. That's more. It's more. It's funnier than my student example, I think. So, okay, this is a data structure. Some would say that this is a JSON. I will get into JSON in a bit, but this is an array. You see the array bracket? It's an array consisting of objects. So it's just an array of objects. So if we console.log courses, was it called that? Yes, courses. Yeah, we see that we get another notation, but it's just objects in an array. This is a typical data you get from a REST API, for instance. So if you call an API, you want to get all the messages from Facebook, from their API, then you will get something like this, typically. And the problem is, when you got this, the filter methods on the API that you were calling wasn't good enough. You couldn't get it fine-tuned, so you need to do some fine-tuning yourself. And in this case, we want to find out how many students are taking distance learning courses that use GitHub as an URL. Okay, so we want to calculate the number of students who are of the type distance and has an URL that starts with that basically. So it's that one and it's that one. So 35 plus 55, so 90, hopefully. So the result should be 90. How would you go about doing this? Any ideas? How would you do it in Java? What would be the first thing you would do?
Iterate.
Yeah. Having some kind of if statement, checking the type.
Checking for the type and the distance.
Yeah, checking the type distance.
And then second, checking for the URL.
Yeah, checking the URL, some kind of substring and checking the URL. Adding them to a new array, I guess.
Yeah.
Those results. Yeah, or yeah, just adding the number of students, you could do that. You actually don't need to save them, maybe. That's a totally valid way of doing this, and you can do it in JavaScript as well, but I will show you another way of doing it. And that's using iterator functions. Once again, we have those MapReduce filter. Okay. You were onto something. You said, okay, the first thing we need to do is find the type distance. Okay, so we have our courses. We have a filter function that filters something to type. Filters something according to a condition. So we do a filter. And this one will take a function. Now I will write it as an arrow function. It will take the course as a parameter, and we should return true or false depending on if the type is distance. So if course dot type equals distance. Start off by this new course. Okay, we get the result, we get the 523, we get the 525, and the 1607. So we get those three courses. We don't get the 1607. We have this 1607 two times, but that's okay. But we got the three we needed. Okay, what was the next step? It was finding the...
But can't we add in that same?
Yeah, we could. We could filter on adding to the expression. But I have a reason not doing that. So we take this new course. Array. Coral. And filter it once again. Course. And now we want to filter it on the URL. So course.url.substring null 0.12345678910111213141516171819. Right? If the first part of this one equals https://github.com. I would actually recommend adding the last slash as well, so you don't accidentally get the github.com.se or something like that. Some obscure subdomains. Okay, and we attach that one to GitHub courses. Thank you. 523. Actually, we do it like this instead. GitHub courses dot length. That's an ugly way of doing it, but okay. So we get two. And those are the two we like, we hope. We could look in there, but it's so hard to see in this terminal. window. Okay, the next thing was to add those numbers up, right? So we take our GitHub courses, little courses. Come on. Should just press enter, but I forgot. We could use the reduce iterator. Reduce takes takes an iterator function as usual, but takes two parameters, the last value and the new value of this iterator. Let's see. So I'm doing this the right way. Yeah. I need a break and you need a break, so I just want to check one thing. We will continue this example right after the break, so give me 10 minutes. I would sort the thing out. I must rethink one thing I did. Yeah, so the reason I was kind of confused before the break is I forgot one step, because what this reduce iterator does is if we have an array of numbers 3, 6, 7, 2, 1, and we use the reduce function, as a first parameter, we will get the result of the last reduce iteration. So it will actually take something which is undefined from the beginning and add or subtract or do something with the first element. So if we have 0 to start with, we add 3 to that. So we get 3, then we take that one and combine it with the 6, and then we get 9, and then we combine it with 7, and we get 16, and combine it by 2, and we get 18. So we reduces the array, resulting in the end in an integer, in this case 19. So reducing is taking every element in the array, iterating over them, and doing something with the last result. And to do this, we need an array of integers in this example. This is good because I want to show up something called map. And map is also an iterator function that does that. It remaps something. It alters an object, for instance. So we take the GitHub courses. And we call map with one parameter, that is the course, and we return the course.students. So what this will give us is a new array of only student ints. So we reduced, we don't need all the other fluff. So we created a new array consisting of the 55 and the 35.
What's going to map do, course map?
So map takes, for every iteration, it takes the whole object and selects and returns only one thing, creating a new array with that thing. And that thing was students. So we kind of mapped out all of the student integers. And now we could use reduce, because of course you could do a for loop, iterate, adding them together manually, but that's no fun. Student int dot reduce. And this one wants the previous value, wants a function with the first parameter being the previous number and the second parameter being the next number. So prev and next. like that. And we return what we want to do with the previous number and the next number, and we want to add them together. But the prev here we will have a problem if we run this one. This will be none. No, it will crash even. Oh, I shouldn't have returned there, of course. Oh, it worked. Magic. It shouldn't work, actually. You know why it shouldn't work?
Because we don't have a base case.
Yeah, we don't have a base case. We previous should be undefined, but probably they have a... Okay, so it says that in the... Okay, so it starts with zero. Okay, because I've always done stuff like guarding this, adding a start value. But you don't need that. Okay, that's good to know. So this looks quite cluttered, right? And that's because we are using temporary variables all the time. And you probably don't do that as much when you code. So instead, we rewrite this. And we do it like this. Total, because I mean this, we could, this is the new array. So on the new array, we could call filter directly. We don't need to store it in the git in a new course and call it on a new course. So we can get rid of all of this. We can get rid of all of this. We should not have semicolons in this case. So in this case, the semicolon actually makes it worse if we forget them. And we reduce that. That. So this is quite a neat way of working with iterator functions. You can chain them like this. So filter will return, you will filter, this is quite easy to read. Okay, we take the courses, we filter out all courses that has type distance, and we filter all courses that have this substring stuff, and we are interested in the number of students, and then we reduce them. You could probably argue that you could maybe write less code if you have a for loop and chain conditions together. But this is kind of a quite good way of using this stuff.
And the filter and reduce, they are now higher order functions.
Yes, all of those are higher order functions because they operate on other functions.
And then you chain them together.
Yeah, and then we chain them together. And if you have done, I know you have done some jQuery, right? So you are probably quite familiar with chaining stuff because one do that tends to do that a lot in jQuery. You did not do that a lot in JavaScript before, iterator functions and stuff, but you can do it like this. Of course, you can add, you don't need arrow functions, you can add function, but if you add function, the function declaration inside of this, you will get a lot of curly brackets, a lot of parentheses, and this code will be 6 times as long. So in this case, arrow functions makes it quite easy to read. Check out MPJ's example of this. He probably explains this a lot better than I did. Okay. We will go through some patterns leading up to classes. Patterns of creating objects. Because what's the problem with creating objects like I did? Like creating object 1 and 2 and just making them. You will find yourself in a situation where you need a lot of objects. And you can't like write them all manually and you forget to sometimes you use a capital N on name and sometimes you don't, so you have mismatch between what they are called. In those cases you use classes in Java because you say the definition in the class and then you just mold new objects out of the class. So How do we do it in JavaScript? Well, we have the factory pattern that you are kind of familiar with, I guess, maybe. Or you will, are you taking the OOAD course, some of you, with Tobias?
What?
You have done it last year?
Yeah.
What course?
Yeah, the object-oriented analysis and design. Okay, last year, good. I guess you talked about patterns and stuff there. But... Mm-hmm. Is it that one? Hello. Where did it go? Where is my... Hallå. Men kom igen. It's there. Hallå. So that is what Apple will fix tonight. The full screen. Okay. No, they won't. Yeah, the factory pattern. Just pasting it in. So instead of creating the objects manually, you could create a function that creates objects. So we have a create student function that takes two parameters, name and age, and returns a new object setting the name and the age, those properties, being those. So in this case, it's quite, I could do it like this to show what maps to what, but like that. So we can call that function, create student, adding a name and age, and pushing it into a students array, for instance. So this is a factory for objects. Okay, yeah?
Does every object created with this factory point, like the greet part, does that point to the same memory, like function as the function allocated?
Yeah, good question. Is every object created by this factory creating new instances of the function greet in the memory? Yes, they are. So they will all have separate greet functions. They won't point to the same function. We could, however, if we like, do something like this. So we are creating one. No, we can't put it there either. We need to put it there. So in this case, we are creating one greet function. And that greet function, we just send a reference to that greet functions to every object we create. So now they are using the same greet function without duplicating it in memory. So you could do it like this, if you like. Some optimizations in ES6, if you have the parameter, or if you have variables in the outer function that corresponds to the object literal, you can skip this part. So you could do it like this. So this object will start looking to connect this name to that variable and copying the argument, and the same with age and the same with the greet. So this one should, in theory, work as well. So this is a simple factory pattern, and it's good just to know that, I mean, this is one way of creating objects in JavaScript. I won't dwell upon that any longer. We will go further. We will look at something called the constructor pattern. And now you're getting words that you are familiar with. Constructor, we know what that is, right? Because you have that in classes. So this is called the constructor pattern. And we have something called constructor functions. This is the should I say, old way of doing classes kind of in JavaScript. We have a new way, so you don't need to memorize this if you don't like to. But it's good to know anyway. So I have a function like this. Do you see anything, if we just look at the declaration of the function, do you see anything that differs from how I have written functions before? Okay. If we skip the inner part, we just look at the declaration of the function. I have a capitalized S, right? So that indicates that, oh, this is not a regular function. This is a type. In Java, you name classes with a capital first letter, right? So this is like mimicking that. You don't need to. It's not a syntax stuff connected to this, but it's good practice that if you are creating a constructor function, this is a constructor function, you should add a capitalized first letter so we know that it is. Because constructor functions are supposed to be called with a keyword new. I haven't used new at all, more or less, until now. So you are familiar with that. Push new student Peter 32 into the array. This is more like it if we talk Java. And this works because this is when it's called with a new keyword, when a function, whatever function, when it's called with a new keyword, it, instead of returning undefined, if we don't return anything ourselves, it will return this. And a function, remember, is an object. So it will kind of return itself. It returns the object of the function when it's called with new. I have explicitly written return this in this case, but you don't, because you don't need to. If a function is called with new, it will return this if you don't return anything else, but you shouldn't. If you call it without the new keyword, it will return undefined. So you can use this for basically making objects as well. So what this will do is when you call it with new, it will create an object. It will set its name to that one. It will set the age to that one. It will implement a greet method on the object. And then the object will be returned and you can use it. The same thing here, this greet method, it will be duplicated for every instance that you create. But that's the same thing in Java. So if the compiler doesn't do a lot of stuff, which I guess it does, but kind of. You don't have a reference back to the class in Java and running the code on the class. Yep.
You don't have, because all of the properties here are public, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I'm coming to that as well. That's the next step. So all of those are public. So if I write down below, I could write student.h and alter that directly because they are public on this object. We could create console log student 0. Forget that. We just log one student. And you will see that, we get a pretty output, I think. We get it that this has a type, this object. So we actually get the type. I didn't see that before. We get the type before the object. So this is an object of the type student, and it has a name and an age and a greet function. So it's basically an object, but we have created it in a slightly different way. Okay? This object has every object has a pointer or reference back to its own constructor. The one or the constructor function, and you can reach it by the constructor. You can't see it here, but it's actually the object has it. So if we run that one, we will see that the constructor function of this object is the function student. So we have a reference back, and I will get back to prototype chains in a little bit. Okay, that leads us onward, because as you said, this one is duplicated. For every instance of student, this one is duplicated. So if we have a lot of code inside of this greet, we will get a lot of memory uses out of nothing. So we could use something called prototypes. So objects have something called prototypes. I will show a picture of this. And objects prototypes is reached by using the dot prototype keyword. So instead of adding this to this object, we could remove it, add it down here to student.prototype, like that. This will still work. Well, student0.greet. It did not. Jo! Nej, student greet. Students. I'm not sure what I did, but it works because we are iterating all the students and calling the greet method, and they are greeting, so it works. I did something wrong on that line. If we would look in the memory now, we only have one greet method, and every object created has a reference to this greet method. And we see this keyword prototype. What's going on here? And this is one key concept that is really good to know. So all objects in JavaScript have something called a prototype object. And when we create objects, we can actually tell the object if it should use another object as a prototype. So those instances, those are instances down here, student 0 and student 1. They have a reference, a hidden reference, pointing back to this prototype object. And when we wrote student.prototype, we moved the greeting method from down here up to this student prototype object. Okay, so what will happen when we ask student 0 to greet? The interpreter will look in the instance and look for a greet method. It won't find any because there are no greet methods on the instances. Then it will go up the prototype chain. It will look at its prototype, kind of like how functions looked at the outer scope. So it will go up one level in the prototype chain, and it will look, is there a greet function here? Oh, yeah, there is a greet method here. Fine. Then I will use that greet method, but I will call it with this student instance as the state. So if I use this inside the greet method, this will point to the student 01, student 0. So we will get the right name and the age and stuff. This is kind of like inheritance, right? If you can almost see it like those instances are inheriting from the prototype. And this is how you do inheritance in JavaScript. You are making chains of prototype objects. You could tell this student prototype to have another prototype, and another, and another, and you can build hierarchies of inheritance. However, I think in Java, if you inherit something in Java, everything inherited is like copied down, right, to the new instances. But in this case, we have an active chain going up the tree and looking in all prototypes. So there's a difference there. How many prototypes
Prototype chains?
In the prototypes, you can, a prototype is just an object. So you can have how many prototypes you like. But one object always has one prototype. So you can't do like multiple inheritance stuff where you would have two prototypes combining to one. So it's always one object has one prototype, and that prototype can have another prototype. But you could, of course, tree down or tree out. So how do you create? Yeah, you have the student prototype. That's the prototype,
yeah.
Because we have one type. And this is the constructor function. So this is actually an object, but that is the constructor function, and that has a pointer to the prototype as well. And if we write dot constructor, that I could do, I could find the constructor function. So this is the constructor function, and this is the prototype, and this is the instances. I could just, do I have maybe an example of that? Yeah. Let's take this one. Okay. I've just created an object person, has a name and an age and a greet method. And then I create a new object student using, I mean, I could do a lot of stuff manually. I could alter the student's prototype by the prototype keyword and stuff. But in ES6, we have a better way of doing this, and that's using object.create. So if you're using object.create, you create new objects, but where you can say as a argument, the first argument is what other object should be the prototype of the new object. So in this case, student would be a new object with person as its prototype. So this is basically saying that students should inherit person. So if we do something on the student, student dot name console log, we get the NN because we haven't altered the name, so it was defaulted to NN, but we can reach it. And of course, we could create, say that staff is also a instance of person. And we can, if we like, let first grader, no, you can't start with a one. First grader be object.create student. So basically, we have created a prototype chain. So a first grader has the prototype as a student. So first grader is an instance of student, which is an instance of person. So this is an inheritance chain, more or less. And when you do stuff on the first grader, it will first look in the first grader object. If it doesn't find it, it will go up to the prototype, which is student, and look for it there, and so on. So you can always override. So you could say that, okay, I want to create a new greet method on the first grader, and you will overwrite. Or no, you won't override. You will override the greet method for the first graders, but you won't alter the greet method in the prototypes.
And if you assign a new property to students, that property will be available for a student.
Yep. Student dot ID equals however, when you're dealing with primitive types like strings and numbers, they are copied. I would try to assign or add something to the ME, we could try that. If I try to add something to the ID, like that, we print it. Yeah, we're adding it to that one, but if we get to the student and look at the ID, it's still the original one, because when you're altering the primitive types, a local copy will be created on the instance from the prototype. Okay, we have to accept that, the prototype chain. To the question about public and private, because those are like concepts that in Java, when I read Java and C Sharp and C++, I mean, there were lectures only about accessibility of variables, like private, public, private, protected and stuff, because that was really, really important. In the Java community, I think that encapsulation isn't the common consensus is that encapsulation isn't that necessary. Harder to test stuff if all, everything is private. You need to do stuff to be able to test code. So in many cases in JavaScript programs, there is much more public properties and functions than in Java, I should say. But however, we can do stuff. If we have a look at this example with a prototype and the constructor pattern, we have the student type. Name and age in this case, they are private because they are only as accessible. They are local variables inside the constructor function. However, when we do this, we are making a private or public property and assigning it the name. So now we have a public property called name and age. This one on the prototype, this will also be public. If we were to add like a function inside of this one, let priv equals a function like that, do stuff. This function will be private because it will only exist inside of the constructor function. We can't call it from the outside if we are not doing that, because now we are making it public again. Okay? You can have a look at those examples on your own time. They just work. I've tried them out, so they work. Whoa, no. What did I do? Pasted it into the console. Ah! Come on. Okay. So typically you'll do something like this, right? You will create some kind of setters and getters. So we have this dot set name that takes a name and it sets that name to the private property name. So we can store the name inside of this object in a private way. And the only way to access the name is through the getters and the setters, and we can have some fancy validation, minimum length, and we can make sure that, yeah, we could only return this in under certain conditions or something like that. So this is a setter and a getter, and we call the set name on the parameter that we get to the constructor function, so that we are sure that the setter always is will always be run, even if we are constructing new objects. So that's one way of encapsulating stuff, if you like. The problem is that this greet method cannot access private properties because not even this function has access to this function above. So we need to call it using the getter in this case. Okay, we should clutter this even more. As I said, just have faith. I will show another way. But this is just to so that you know what led up to the way we have. I removed use strict. So we have defined property. This is new in ES5, I think. We have the object.define property. And this makes it so we can do getters and setters the same way that I think you have in Java and C#. So you don't need to call a function. You can just call the or assign it as a variable, more or less, or a property. And the getter and the setter will intervene. What this says is, OK, so object.define a property for the name property. And we want a get, and we want a set, and we write the code that the get and the set will do. In this case, on the set, I always add those minuses just to see that something is happening. So this is making getters and setters using the defined property. It's quite a cluttery way of doing it, but it's possible. And at the end, I call this.name, and now name will map to this property, and the setter will be run with the name coming into the constructor function. So we don't forget that. So even when we are constructing new objects, the setter will be run. Okay. Oh, it's getting cluttery, right? Getting worse and worse. Okay, now you will be happy, because in the ES2015, they added classes. So if you are familiar with classes, you will probably love this. I can honestly say that the whole of the... Why do I do that? The JavaScript community is really, really divided in this matter. There are those who strongly oppose us to add classes to JavaScript. Uh-oh, is this booked? Oh. Are you going to be in here? No?
No.
Great. Just a couple of minutes more. Because this is a way of mimicking how stuff works in Java. And those hardcore functional programmers don't want classes. They want to do stuff other ways. However, they have all agreed in the standards committee, and classes are here, and they will stay here. So you can add classes. So the way we wrote stuff with a defined property and adding functions to the prototype and stuff, it's all encapsulated in another syntax that is more easy to read, I think. Instead of adding a constructor function, you say it's a class. And you encapsulate all of the class inside of brackets. You're used to that as well. You have this keyword constructor, which is the constructor of the function, of the class. Okay, a little bit syntactical difference between Java and this, but I think you can know what's going on right here. And we add a prototype function greet, and we add a get name. So instead of defining property and stuff, we just use the keyword get, and name will be a property. And the same with a set. And now we could do it like this. As it's actually the same as the last example, but this code is cleaner. So you could create a new student, you can assign a name, and the setter will be run, and so on. Or something like that. I'm not sure what I'm running. I haven't saved. Okay. So with your background, if you want to create classes, this is a really good way of starting. Then you have a keyword called extends. So if you want to do prototype inheritance, you could do it using the Java style, using extend, so you can extend other classes. But what is important to know, that in the background it doesn't work like Java. what you will do using the extend is that you will alter the prototype change. And so you have those prototypes there in the background. It's just another syntax way of writing stuff. Yeah, I actually had an example. I'm not sure if you see, but this is a class polygon. This is a class square that extends polygon, and we call the super to get to the super class. And so you are probably familiar with this way of looking at inheritance. I will skip that one. Because I need to get to this, it's the last thing of today. So when I've written code right now, I've written everything in one file, app.js. So if I would to do console.log this, I won't get much out of that. Why don't I do that? Well, okay, I guess that's how Node handles it then. I expected to get a lot of stuff because we are now operating in kind of the global scope. We have no scope. We haven't encapsulated anything. And the way to encapsulate stuff is to... Oh, actually, this file is actually scope, so that makes sense. The file is one scope, and we don't have access to the global scope in Node from here. If we had done this in the browser, however, this would have given us the window object, that is the global object in the browser. In JavaScript and in ECMAScript, or I should say, we have something in Node that are called Node modules, and they work kind of like this, that you can export stuff from this file and import it in other, or require it in other files. So if I in one file wants to export, say, three functions, say hello in English, say hello in Spanish, and say hello in Swedish, and then this is just the arrow functions that returns hello, hola, or hey. I could then, in another file, let's do it like this instead. In the hello.js, we are exporting those methods, and in the app.js, we want to use those functions. We require hello. I don't add the file type.js. I just write the name of the file. Because this is a local file, I use the ./ to indicate that this is not a built-in type. This is something that this is a file, basically. So it will look for the file hello. Of course, I could have this structured in subfolders and stuff. I require this one. Greet will now be an object with those functions attached to it. So we can say greet, say hello in Spanish. So this is the way modules kind of work. And you will need to separate stuff into modules. How to do this with a class? Well, we have a class. Like this, the class. And then we add module.export and we export the class. And on the other end, the hello, this one, will be the student. And then we could do new student. Koan I will be called. I'm not 45, but whatever. And we got an error. What did I do wrong? I'm too tired. Student is not a constructor. What did I mess up? Student require that one. Come again?
There's no age in the constructor and the student.
Oh, there weren't, but...
Yeah, did you maybe also forget to save the hello?
Aha! Thank you! Yeah. And we have connected the two of them. So this is quite a neat way to do this. This is exclusive for Node. This is the Node, how Node handles modules. In ES6, we have a new model for this. It's not implemented anywhere, not even in Node. This model will work in Node forever and ever. The new model, the ES6 modules, will work eventually, and they will work in the browsers eventually as well. We don't have modules in the browser yet. We don't even have those modules in the browser. I will show you a way to get modules into the browser, but that's another story. Somewhere on the line, you will start using the ES ECMAScript modules instead of those. But for now, we are stuck with those. And those are the ones being used as well when it comes to the new Node community. Oh my God, that was a lot of topics. The next year, this will be 4 lessons, I guess, or something like that. Okay, so the purpose of those two lectures was to get you up to speed with JavaScript and see kind of the differences between JavaScript and Java. Try to experiment, read in the book. We don't have any assignments to this specific lectures, but the next assignment will be writing a web application, some kind of quiz application with REST APIs and stuff. And in that, in creating that application, you will need to be kind of up to date with JavaScript. You can do stuff on the examination assignments and in the, like however you like to code. You can use classes and inheritance. You can use functional programming. You can kind of find your own way because you could do it. Remember the guy dancing on the treadmill. You can do it however you like, more or less. So please explore for yourself. That's what I have to say. I will, on the course page, right now I have linked to what I said on the first lecture. Tomorrow I will also add links to this second lecture, but it's the part one in, as I said, in the Eloquent JavaScript. And the neat thing with this one is that you can, in the book, you can alter the examples. And I think run them and see the result. So if you want to start experimenting, please use the book because it's pretty good. And install Node. And tomorrow and Friday, make sure that you have the connection with GitHub for the first assignment. We will be on Slack to help you. Maybe not so much on Friday, but a lot tomorrow. Okay. I will be here if you have questions after the lecture as well. So, okay, I will say thank you for all of you on remote, and thank you for all of you attending the class. Thanks.